Good morning, DCC. Welcome to this beautiful sunny day again. So it's estimated that the average person speaks about 9 million words a year, and more than half are I, me, my, and mine. But following Christ means dying to self, and self-centeredness doesn't give up without a fight. That's why Paul writes, everything connected with getting our own way is killed off for good. Self-interest won't just roll over and die, it must be killed. And it's a daily battle, because we have a tendency to cling to our own interests with a death grip. Jesus told his disciples, whoever desires to be first, let him be your slave. Matthew 20:27. In those days, the slave was considered to be the lowest employee among the household servants. That means you have been called to sacrifice your own interests in order to serve others. And if he has to, God will leave you with a reminder of what it took to get through to you in your particular area of stubbornness and self-centeredness. For example, after his encounter with God, Jacob walked with a limp, but it was a constant reminder of his total dependence on God. And the great apostle Paul writes, so I wouldn't get a big head. I was given the gift of a handicap to keep me in constant touch with my limitations. 2 Corinthians 12:7. What's your handicap? A habit you battle? A fear that dogs to your tracks? A difficult relationship? A financial shortfall? A physical ailment? Why doesn't God just take it away? Because he considers anything that makes you more dependent on him and less dependent on yourself a plus and not a minus. Can we please sing 506, O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder. Can we stand, please?
Bring them on.
can we just bow our heads in prayer? Father, we just want you to be here in the presence this morning, Lord. Whatever people come with this morning, Lord, please let them just feel free to leave it outside this building and just take off all them chains, Lord, all them burdens, all them sufferings. And Lord, please just let us be here in one to honour and praise, give praise to you this morning, Father. Amen. So, again, like I always say, I'm thinking, I'm always about Monday, I start to think, right, Lord, what is it this week? And then I read it. That was the word for today, by the way, for Sunday. And I hadn't read that till this morning. And then when I read it, I decided that was what my opening was going to be. So thank you, Lord. Other than that, the adverts are about Halloween. I'm finding that when I drive around, it's around Halloween. Now, and I was looking for a photograph because I've got a photograph of myself and my mum and Stefan and my stepdaughter all dressed up for a Halloween party. Now, I have to say, this is when I was a Christian and, you know, I was an adult. But since then, every year at Halloween, I have kind of a conviction on my heart about what is happening. And I think, I don't know if you agree, but there's more horror films nowadays on the TV. Society's become more, what I would say, more, it's more exciting. This skull, you know, I see a top with a skull and I'm like, oh, I can't buy that. Can't have a skull on my top. So I did a bit of research. And interestingly enough, when you put in Christianity and Halloween, this all seems to be American. But that's probably because it's the American, yeah. But I've watched a lot of them. And I hope, now I don't want anybody to feel offended or anything, but I have chose one just to play this morning that it's a gentleman, he's a pastor, and it's thought-provoking, but it's also, for me, what Christianity is at Halloween and what we should be. Thanks, Neil.
What does the Bible say about Halloween? Well, nothing, and a whole lot. It says nothing about the specific date, October 31, when people dress up and go around to people's homes and get candy. It says nothing about the specific date. But it has a lot to say about biblical principles that apply to how we behave on October 31st. Now, this is absolutely standard. There are many things today that weren't around in the biblical world. Nuclear waste, you know, do cell phones cause brain cancer? Many things that the Bible doesn't address simply because they weren't around in biblical times. But that doesn't mean that there aren't principles that we should pay attention to and learn from that are very important for us to learn from. Now, I want to say right up front, I don't want to get into the history of Halloween. A lot of Christians, when they talk about Halloween, want to get into the history of it and how it started and what's been involved through the ages. I really don't think that's as important as the principles that are involved. You know, for example, let's take just even the days of the week, like Sunday is related to the worship of the sun. Monday is related to the worship of the moon. Thursday is related to the god Thor. But I don't think I'm being irreligious or that a Christian is somehow dishonoring God by saying Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, even though those names historically are rooted in the worship of pagan gods. What I think is more important when we're looking at things like Halloween is, what does the Bible say about how we should behave? Now, we know that the Bible says there is a God and there is good and there is a devil. There is a devil and there is evil. And there's a spiritual war that's raging between good and evil. And every person makes a choice about whether they want to serve God or not serve God.
And
it's the two sides, God's side and the devil's side, are very much warring. God is trying to get people to honor him, bless him, recognize him, obey him, so that he can have, they can be saved, and that he can bless them with everlasting life. The devil, on the other hand, is getting people to worship and obey him. He's trying to get people to worship and obey him. And if he can't do that, he's trying to get people to not honor God. And this is so-called vast majority of people that they say, well, I don't, you know, they're not overtly evil. They're not overtly godly in the sense that they don't go to church, they don't read their Bible, they don't pray. But they say, but I'm a good person. It's very important to understand that the devil's really trying to get, if he can't get you to worship him, he wants you to be a good person, just so God doesn't get any honor or credit. And there's a huge battle about that. You know, there are people that have sold themselves out to do what is evil. They're professional thieves, or they're murderers, or they're liars, and they do the works of their father. But the devil is just as invested in getting people to simply not honor God. If you won't worship the devil, can the devil get you to where you don't honor God? You see, it's like in the spiritual world of things, there are those people, and I count myself as one, and perhaps you count yourself as one, who get up and I pray, I read my Bible, I really in my life, I try to honor God with what I do. And then there are those people that don't care at all about God, and they are going to be firmly in the camp of the adversary. They are going to do evil in their life. But the majority of the people are just kind of background noise. And, you know, it's kind of interesting in light of that. What's background noise? Background noise is just, it's noise that keeps you distracted, noise that keeps you from hearing things clearly. This morning I was on my cell phone with a friend of mine, and he was driving down the road. He was talking on his Bluetooth little device, you know, that hands-free device in the phone, and he was driving past something that he needed to take a picture of. So he stops the car, he gets out of the car, he walks away from the car. Meanwhile, I'm still with him. Well, in just literally seconds, I'm hearing... Now, he's still talking, and if I really worked, I could hear him, but most of it was just... And then eventually he got back in the car and we could talk clearly again. See, that's what the devil wants people to do. He wants people, you're not going to worship me, says the devil, if you're not going to obey me, and I want you as part of the general background noise. Now we have to be clear that if you're part of the background noise, even though you might think of yourself as a good person, oh, well, no, yeah, I'm not really a godly person, and I don't really obey God or do any of those religious things, but I'm a good person. I think we need to listen very carefully to Jesus Christ here. Here's what Jesus Christ himself had to say. He said, he who is not with me is against me, and he who does not gather with me scatters. That's Matthew chapter 12, verse 30. See, from a spiritual perspective, there is a God, there is a devil, there is a spiritual war between them, and everything we do contributes to one side or the other of that spiritual war. Now, the Bible walks a very fine line. There's a very fine line that the Bible walks between informing us about the devil and glorifying the devil. So for example, even the names of the devil in the Bible aren't names. Did you know that we don't even know his actual real name? There's not one title of the devil in the Bible that actually is his name. I know people. Some people say, well, his name is Lucifer. That's not a name. That was a designation. Well, anyway, it was a designation of the planet Venus and the morning star, but that's not his name. Devil means slanderer, Satan means adversary, he's called the enemy, he's called the wicked one, he's called the tempter. He's got this whole bunch of names in the Bible, but they don't glorify him. They inform us about him and who he is. So the Bible walks a fine line between information and glorification, and we do too. You and I in our lives have to learn to walk a fine line between informing others about the devil and helping others obey God. And frankly, Halloween is one of those times that desensitizes people to the devil in the spiritual fight. We see cute little ghosts walking around. We see witches on walls. You know, those are demonic. If you're a witch, then you are against God and Jesus Christ. The very nature of witchcraft is control, and control over people and control over things in an ungodly way. Yeah, you know, see, on Halloween, what do you see? You see ghosts, you see witches, you see demons, you see gory people, evil people, people that have killed skulls and crossbones and that kind of thing. Those are against God. And when you put on that kind of thing, that even if you say, well, I don't mean any real harm by it, again, we're just becoming part of the general background noise that says, you know what? The things of God, they aren't very important. I mean, what God thinks about the devil, what God thinks about ghosts, what God thinks about witches, those things aren't very important. They are important. And we don't want to be a part of the general background that dishonors God. As Christians, we want to get to the point that what we do in our life honors God. Now, let me just talk very quickly about a couple alternatives. There's nothing wrong with having a harvest party. There's nothing wrong with having a costume party, and those things are certainly available. Something else you might want to know about is on October 31st in 1517, Martin Luther nailed the 95 Theses to the door at Wittenberg, which is generally credited as the date that started the Christian Reformation. Can you have a party on October 31st? Absolutely. Why not have a Reformation party and pray and talk about things that will glorify God and move the Word? Or have a harvest party at the end of the year and have a wonderful time getting together and doing things that honor God. Remember, what we want to ask ourselves is what I'm doing honoring God, or is it simply desensitizing people and adding to the background noise that says that not honoring God is okay? Let's ask ourselves those important questions. God bless you.
So thanks for bearing with me. It was a bit long, but I don't know. When I watched it, I've watched it about 3 times just to make sure. But like I said, Halloween is all over the news. Some people may think it's harmless. I'm glad dressing up isn't harmless, because I was dressed up for Joe's 21st a few weeks ago, my costume party. But just something to make people think really about honouring God as Halloween. And people do ask the question sometimes, you know, well, when you make it quite clear that I don't really support Halloween nowadays, the simple answer to me now is because I honour God, and to support Halloween would be really taking that honour away. Can we now just stand and sing, please? Oh, I haven't done the notices. So Mondays and Fridays, 8:30 a.m, Rise and Shine, our parent and toddler group. Mondays at 12:45. Have we got the Life's group back up yet? Ooh. Bess at 3:30, Pete and Brian 7:30. Oh, it's church meeting. Sorry, what time? 7:00. Pardon? Yeah. Yeah, ladies' prayer meeting tomorrow, and that will be usually. Are we doing it earlier now, Joy? Or is it 6, 7 till 8 still? 7 till 8. We'll probably just log on a bit earlier if anybody wants a chat. Okay, so has anybody got the collection pouches? Can I not see them? They'll come round as we stand to sing our second hymn, which is Wonderful Grace, please.
Wonderful grace that gives what I don't.
Oh, sorry, here in church, we've just had to stop. Oh, technical hitch, technical hitch. Take two.
Good morning, everyone. Hope that standing drummer didn't put you off too much. Still managed to worship okay, yeah? Yeah? All the crash banging and all that sort of stuff. Every time I play, I always think to myself, you know what? I'll put some practice in, and I never do, as you can see. So there you go. So this morning, I just wanted to, before Julie reads our scripture, we've got some announcements, we've got some things we want to pray for. The first announcement, like has been said, is this Wednesday we're having our church meeting at 7 o'clock. It'll be here in this room and on Zoom. So if you are able to be here, by all means, please do. If you can't, log on Zoom. And obviously we're discussing all the stuff that we've been talking about in regards to questions and queries that people have in regards to the future of our buildings. But also what I want to talk to you about is Christianity Explored. We've been talking, or I've been talking rather, about trying to start a course. We are going to start the course next Sunday evening. Okay, we're going to do it. Hallelujah. And it'll start at 5, probably run from 5 through till 6. I know that Emma tried to get some sort of rota together. So if you were included on that, I'll be trying to contact you this week and just check you're okay to do something. But I've got a small introductory video that I'm going to get Neil to play for us. I think it's 3 minutes long. We'll just have a brief look at it and see what it tells us about Christianity Explored.
Who do you say I am? Jesus once asked his followers this question. Who do you say I am? A prophet with a new teaching? A healer to the sick? A savior to a lost world? Jesus claimed each of these, but most importantly, he claimed to be God in the flesh. At the dawn of time, he ignited human history when he spoke. He breathed life into the lungs of the first man and woman and every inch of creation itself. But we rebelled. We turned against our King and followed our own ways, even though it would cost us our life. Our sin poisoned his perfect creation, giving way to sickness, injustice, and death. Sin separated us from one another and from God. But rather than cast off humanity, God sent his Son, Jesus, to enter into the world he created, the one broken by our sin. He breathed our air, became human like us. But he lived a perfect life, the one God intended we live, and called us to repent of our sin and follow him in faith. Some believed his word and recognized him as king. Others denied him. They crowned him with thorns and murdered him. They rejected him, and so have we. But God had a plan. Jesus willingly gave himself up to die on a cross to save us from God's judgment and the death we deserve. On that cross, he exchanged our rebellion for his obedience, our brokenness for his perfection. The Son of God died so we could live. And on the third day, he rose to life again, defeating death forever. Now he sits on the throne of heaven, offering life through the Holy Spirit to all those who repent and trust in him. Jesus is the King of Kings. You can either crown him or crucify him. There is no middle ground. No one will ever ask you a more important question than the one Jesus asks. Who do you say I am?
Thanks, Neil. So that just gives you a little taster. Now, when you do the Christianity Explored course, it is informal. So we try to start off with a little bit of food. That's always good. And then there's some videos. Then there's a little bit of discussion. And it just takes you through. It's going to run for 8 weeks. So that's going to be 8 Sunday evenings that we'll be running it for. Mark Yearden, who has been here to speak, he's going to be helping us. So he's going to come over all the way from sunny Leeds and help us support that. So essentially, I think we are good to go. If you're interested in it, please let me know, and we will book you on it. I think I've got 2, maybe 4, possibly 5 people that have expressed an interest. But what it is it's an informal way to find out about the Christian faith. Really clear, really simple, but covers the basics. It's a good grounding. And it's, you know, I've done the course once already, led the course, and it's refreshing for me because there are certain things that you go through, you think, yeah, I need to hear these truths. Okay. So if you're interested, come and talk to me. It'll be, like I say, an informal setting, bit of video, bit of discussion, bit of food, and we'll be starting next Sunday. Okay. So therefore tonight, 6 till 7, I'm going to ask us to pray for that, pray in advance of that. So that'll be on Zoom prayer meeting tonight, 6 till 7, in the hope that we can get enough people on there and see what the Lord does there. Okay, so I'm going to ask you to stand and we're going to have a prayer. We're going to pray for some people. Let's go before God. the radio mic. Is that better? Yeah, okay. So we are going to pray for, we're going to keep Brenda in prayer. She's got some ongoing illnesses that we just wanted to clear, you know, break free from. We've got Ron and Scott, who we're going to keep in prayer. Suzette as well. If you know of anyone that is in need of prayer, and I haven't mentioned them, or you think that they are, you know, you want to pray for them, we're going to, you know, give them that time now. Pray from now. We'll go together. We'll believe God, trust God that God's going to do something. Let's pray. Father, as we come before you, the living God, and we've prayed for many, many people, Lord, and you've answered so many prayers. And some prayers get answered straight away, and some prayers, they take a long time, Father. And we do not know why that is, but what we do know is that you hear us. And so as we come before you, we are expectant, we are hopeful because of you. Not because of us, not because of anything that we've done, but because of what you have done, Father. And so we know we can go before what we call the throne of grace, and we can profess and ask that you would move and touch people's lives and transform as only you can. In Jesus' name, amen. While you stood up, go and say hello to someone. Be social and be brave. Okay. Sorry? No. Okay, if you'll get your Bibles open and Julie's going to read for us. Chatty, aren't they? You can come and stand there if you want.
So today's reading is from 1 John In your turquoise Bible, it is page 1225. So it's chapter 1. We're reading from verse 5 to verse 10. The heading is Light and Darkness, Sin and Forgiveness. This is the message we have heard from him and declare to you. God is light. In him there is no darkness at all. If we claim to have fellowship with him and yet walk in the darkness, we lie and do not live out the truth. But if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. And the blood of Jesus, his son, purifies us all sin. If we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just, and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. If we claim we have not sinned, we make him out to be a liar, and his word is not in us.
Thank you, Julie. Let's pray, Father. This is, as always, your word. It's not the word of man, it is the word of the living God. We honour you, Father. We want truth in our hearts this morning. We pray that our hearts be open and be receptive in Jesus' name. Amen. I don't know how your week's been, but my week started off pretty rubbish because, am I all right closing this up and moving wherever Julie's moving and all that? Is that okay? She's not here. She's done a runner already. So I was due to come to church. I had a plan for my day on Monday, and I couldn't find the keys for my car. And the usual thing is you'll go and get the spare. Didn't have a spare. Don't know where the spare's gone. So I literally all day, I mean, I looked everywhere. I mean, like couch, laundry basket, emptied that out, did everything, looked everywhere. About 6 o'clock, my wife comes home. And she says to me, have you checked? And I said, of course I've checked. Your jeans? Yeah, I've checked my jeans. What jeans were you wearing? I checked them. What about your coats? I said, I've checked my coats. I've checked me. I've got the black. I wore the black. I've checked my green coat. Oh, I didn't check my blue coat, did I? When I checked my blue coat, I found my key, didn't I? So a long, frustrating day could have been avoided by just simply talking to my wife and asking, you know what I mean? Because, you know, I knew she'd know. I knew she'd find it for me. But hey-ho, it wasn't to be. So all day, on and off, I was looking in all manner of strange places for keys that were in my coat pocket, which was frustrating because I was meant to be somewhere else. But there you go. So this morning, we're looking at 1 John 1 verses 5 to 10. I've called this series, we're going to work through this letter, and I've called this series Keep It Real. Keep It Real, based on a phrase that the guy who led the church that we used to be, me and my wife, he was always saying that, let's keep it real. Let's keep it real. And what we're doing here is we're trying to, what I think John's doing here, as we'll see, is that John is looking for a real genuine faith. That's what he's looking for, and that's why he writes the letter. Now, there's been some research done from East Anglia University around about 2015, and they wanted to find out how honest people were, okay? And what they did was they set up an online test, and they knew they could work out whether the honesty was right or wrong depending on the answers to this test. And they did it in the following countries: Brazil, China, Greece, Japan, Russia, Switzerland, Turkey, the United States, Argentina, Denmark, the UK, India, Portugal, South Africa, South Korea. More than 1,500 participants from 15 countries took part. So which, here's a question before we get into it, out of all those nations, which do you think was the most dishonest? No one wants to say anything because you'd be branded a racist, won't you? Something like that. I think it was the Argies. Can't say that. Go on. Probably the UK. Ooh, interesting. Anyone else agree? You think it's the UK? Anyone else think it's the UK? Quite a few people. Okay, well, let's dig in and find out. Contestants were asked to flip a coin and state whether it landed on heads or tails. They knew that if they reported that it landed on heads, they would be rewarded with $5. If it landed on tails, they would be rewarded with $3. Okay, so the emphasis really was, are they going to be honest? Now, the proportion of reported heads, if it was more than 50%, that indicated that people were being dishonest, okay? The same participants asked to complete a music quiz. And when, again, they were rewarded financially, if they got the answers correctly, they were asked not to search the answers on the internet and had to tick a box to confirm they had answered on their own, but before moving on to the next question. Three of the questions were deliberately difficult, so it would be highly likely that participants would need to look up the answer. Getting more than one of these three questions right indicated a high probability of cheating. So it's not an absolute, but it'll give you a good idea. Estimated dishonesty in the coin flipping ranged from 3.4% in the UK to 70% in China. There you go. Now, this doesn't mean to say next time you go into the Chinese chippy, you can't trust them. All right, you know what I mean? Just check they've got the right amount of chips there. Check they've got that, you know what I mean? We're not talking about that. It's just an online survey, okay? In the quiz, respondents in Japan were the most honest, followed by the UK. So in the quiz, we were the second. So shame on you for thinking bad about the UK, or you to put your hand up. Anyway. While those in Turkey were the least truthful. And you're all now thinking, yeah, when I was in Turkey, I remember buying something and da-da-da-da-da, you know what I mean? That's the way we think, isn't it? In the coin flip test, the least four honest countries, so the coin flipping, were China. Japan scored very lowly in the coin flip test, South Korea and India. Those were the worst four, okay? So we see honesty differs across the nations. John, as he's writing this first chapter, as he's finishing this first chapter off, he's asking the Christians who he writes to be honest about their relationship with God. That's what he's asking. He wants us to make sure that this honesty is grounded in truth. So he starts where everybody on planet Earth should start with. He starts with God. That's where he starts. And he says this: this is the message we heard from him and declare to you, God is light, and in him there is no darkness at all. So the first subsection is called God is God. And this is the first bit of that, the message. As we've said before, John is dealing with false teachers and their teaching. And so he makes what is quite a simple yet profound statement. The message that we heard from him, simple but profound. Why? Because never in the history of any religion has the claim been made that God appeared in human form and spoke face to face with his creation. Never has this been attested to like it is in Christianity. Never has this been something factual that will stand up in a court of law. It was only at the birth of Jesus Christ that this happened. Christianity is unusual and unique in this claim. Other religions, they claim to have a set of teachings to follow. Buddhism does not claim godlike status, but gives us principles to live by. But the briefest bit of research by an unbiased person will be able to distinguish Christianity from the rest of the religions that are out there by the claims that it makes. The problem that we have when we live in the UK is that most people now are biblically illiterate. If you went back 50, 70 years, around about the 1950s, nearly everybody in the UK at that particular moment in time would have some knowledge of the Bible. You know, there's that story of the two girls and they're walking around doing a little bit of shopping. And they come up to a jewellery shop. And this isn't in my notes, I'm just recalling something, so the accuracy might be a little bit out. And they said, have you seen them little crosses that everyone's wearing? And the second girl goes, yeah, but I'd like one of those crosses without one of those, that little man on it. They don't know what the cross is for. They don't know who was on it. If you take the biblical illiteracy with a media that informs people and a secular education that they received as they grew up, then they are ignorant to the great claims of Christianity and the great good that it does in society. We live in an increasingly hostile environment towards Christianity, and yet Christianity says, bless those that curse you. It says, love our enemies. You know, those two things right there, if all you knew about Christianity was bless those that curse you, love your enemies, what a great benefit to society that is. Is it not? Is that not a good thing? Yeah, it's a good thing. And yet we face more and more subtle hostility. John starts with this awesome claim that the message of the gospel was not a message that was recited through the generations, but God came down. And he spoke to the apostles face to face, and they received it as they would receive anything else, by seeing, by hearing, and by witnessing the remarkable work that Jesus did. They have not diluted this message. They have not sought to change the message. They did not have to make the message culturally appropriate. The message was passed on in its original form, and it does not need any embellishments from us. It still works. It still transforms. It still changes. From the message, you've got the means. What did they do with this message? He says that simple. We declared it. They declared it. I was listening to a guy in Australia, Australian lawyer that represents lots and lots of people in Australia where things are heating up there, and they have got some serious problems in Australia with lockdown and troops on the street. And he says, what he's now going to go and do when he talks to anyone is just say, hi, my name, I can't remember his name. My name is such and such a person. I'm a Christian. Those are the first words out of his mouth. That's challenging. I know Rico Tice, who runs the Christianity Explored that we were just looking at then. He went into all his local news agents and told them that he's a minister of the gospel. Just so they know, so they'd be aware, so they'd be watching him. This is what John says. We just talked about it. We told people about Jesus, what he's done, what he came to do, what he's achieved for us. This message is God's message. It's not my message. It's not yours. We are stewards of this message that God has spoken, and we are to speak to others in whatever way, shape, or form that takes, and we are not to dilute it. From the means and from the message, we get to a simple statement about the Messiah. And he says this, God is light. In him there is no darkness. The God who came down from heaven and took the form of man, he is light. Now in scripture, light could refer to God as a source of knowledge, illumination, guidance. It may point to God's glory, that he is unapproachable. It might mean all of these things, that he's infinite, he's unchangeable, he's omnipresent. But here, the idea is that he is holy. This is indicated by the negative, where he says, and in him there is no darkness. It is the moral connotation that Jesus brought out when he said these words. This is judgment. This is John 3, verse 19. This is the judgment, that light came into the world and men loved the darkness rather than the light, for their deeds were evil. It's a simple statement that is all the more important when we realize what John doesn't say. What doesn't he say? Now remember, he's addressing false teaching. He's near the end of his ministry. He's already written John's gospel. It's probably written between AD 86 and 88. It's approximately 50, maybe 60 years after the church started, after the crucifixion. So what does he write? John, who's known as the Beloved, that's what they call him, John the Beloved, writes, God is light. He does not write, God is love. He doesn't write, God is justice, but he writes, God is light. Now, if you or I were asked the question, describe God to me, most of us, myself included, would probably start with God is love. Oh, God loves you. That's where we always go. Why do we go to God is love? Because everyone likes love, do they not? Anyone not like love in the room this morning? Yeah, Julie? You're being awkward, or are you actually not like, do you not like love? God is love is what would normally go. Because it's a universal quality that everyone can identify with. It's culturally acceptable to start with love. Love is something that everyone can identify with, and there are times when it is necessary. But John says that before we start with anything, we must start with light. Because he starts there, we're on dangerous ground if we start to treat the other qualities of God, like his love and like his justice, without any reference to holiness. We cannot and should not describe love without including holiness. Now, Martin Lloyd-Jones, famous preacher from the 1950s and 1960s, he said this in his book, Fellowship with God. He says, if you don't begin with God's holiness, you'll never understand God's plan of salvation through the cross of Christ. If God is only love, then the cross is unnecessary and meaningless. Point number two, if we start with God's holiness, it exposes all false claims of fellowship with God. In other words, as in John's, many claim to have fellowship with God, but often this is an empty claim based on their own imagination with a false God that they've made up. True fellowship is with the holy God, not a good buddy God. Thirdly, starting with God's holiness saves us from the danger of blaming God in times of trouble. Why is God allowing this? I didn't deserve this. But if we start with God's absolute holiness, we will see that we deserve nothing but his wrath and won't challenge and criticize when trials come. When trials come, have you ever blamed God? Interactive bit there, guys. I'm waiting for an answer. Come on. No. Brian, you're telling lies in church. You need to repent right now. Have you ever blamed God for a trial? Or have you moaned about it? Same kind of thing. The reason I say that is that when I was ill a couple of weeks back, you know, I had the temperature, I had aches, I had pains. And in my head, all that's going through my head is, Lord, I've got too much to do to be ill. That's what I'm thinking. I've got too, you know, the stuff I've got to get on with, Lord. I want to get on with stuff. And is this illness, and you've got to isolate, haven't you? Because you tested positive with COVID. So I'm isolating and I'm just like, and I was so disaffected. I didn't even want to pick my Bible up. I'm wandering around like a bear with a sore head, you know, and the isolation was the hardest part. You know, I ended up trying to walk into rooms backwards for something to do. Well, this is different. Go into that room backwards. That's the next thing. What an exciting day I've had today. But I did blame God. I was not happy with God. I was telling God, God, I've got so much to do. Like he didn't know. I've got so much to do and I'm ill. Why don't you just zap me, heal me and let me get on with stuff? And that went on through the 10, actually I was 12 day isolation because I was super safe. Super safe. And at the end of that, it was my observation about myself that I was blaming God. I was going before him. I was not happy with the situation. I have too much to do. It was his fault. He needs to heal me. That was my attitude to God. What is that at the end of the day? It's a lack of holiness and reverence for him. That's what it is. Now, there is an example in the Bible that we don't like to go to, Job. We don't like to go to Job because what happened to Job was just extreme. So I'm just going to read you the first section of Job. What I didn't do, there we go. What I didn't do was mark it up. Here we go. This is Job. This is the opening chapter of Job. There was a man in the land of Uz whose name was Job. That man was blameless and upright, one who feared God and turned away from evil. There was born unto him 7 sons and 3 daughters. He possessed 7,000 sheep, 3,000 camels, 500 yoke of oxen, 500 female donkeys, and very many servants, so that this man was the greatest of all the people in the East. His sons used to go and hold a feast in the house of each one on his day, and they would send and invite their 3 sisters to eat and drink with them. And when the days of the feast had run their course, Job would send and consecrate them. He would rise early in the morning, offer burnt offerings according to the number of them all, for Job said, "It may be that my children have sinned and cursed God." Okay? So there's Job. There's his life. Then there's a conversation that happens in heaven. The conversation goes on. God says, "Have you seen Job?" Satan says, "That's because you're protecting him. If you take your protection away from him, he will curse you to your face." So God says, "Okay, you can have at him. I'm going to allow it. I'm going to allow evil to happen to my child." And then he says, "But you can't at this particular point hurt him." So this is how it happens. "Now there was a day when his sons and daughters were eating and drinking wine in their oldest brother's house. And there came a messenger to Job and said, 'The oxen were plowing and the donkeys feeding beside them. And the Sabians fell upon them, took them, struck down the servants with the edge of the sword. And I alone have escaped to tell you.'" So some local warlords come and just steal all his stuff. Okay, does that happen in today's society in certain parts of the world? Yeah, it goes on. Next. "While he was yet speaking, there came another. The fire of God fell from heaven and burned up the sheep and the servants and consumed them, and I alone have escaped to tell you." Do we see fires in today's society? We had them over here, didn't we? They were burning on the hills a few years ago. We've seen them in America. We've seen them in Australia. It's here in the Bible, isn't it? "While he was yet speaking, there came another one. The Chaldeans formed 3 groups, made a raid on the camels, took them and struck down the servants with the edge of the sword. I alone have escaped to tell you." You know, there are times when bad things happen to me, and I used to say, at least it can't get any worse. And then I went to Moldova and ended up staying the next street, the very first time I went, and it got worse. I thought God's going to bless me because I'm going to stay here in Moldova and do some more evangelistic work, and it got worse. It was horrendous. So guess what I don't do? Say it can't get any worse. "While he was yet speaking, there came another one. Your sons and daughters were eating and drinking wine in their oldest brother's house. And behold, a great wind came across the wilderness, struck the 4 corners of the house. It fell upon the young people, and they are dead. I alone have escaped to tell you." Do we see in our society today hurricanes, tornadoes? We don't typically see them over here, but we see them around the world, don't we? This is what happened to Job. And not only that, tragedy struck. And it says, "Job arose, shaved his head, fell on the ground. Naked came I from my mother's womb, naked I return. The Lord gave, the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord." In all this, Job did not sin or charge God with any wrong. When I think about that, and when I think about myself and my behavior, I realized that there was something wrong inside here. And I had to sort it out. So I had to go before God and confess sin, irreverence to him. Because actually, being a bit ill, I wasn't particularly bad with it. Being in isolation, it wasn't any great hardship. Lastly, Lloyd-Jones points out this, and this is something that Julie touched on. If we start with God's holiness, it's the only way to true joy. It's easy to have a false peace if you have a user-friendly God. If you bring God down to man's level, then you can enjoy peace with God without dealing with your sins. But it's a false peace that will not hold up on the day of judgment. True peace and joy comes from being reconciled to the holy God through the blood of his son, Jesus. So John begins with God. He says that's our fellowship, God. We must recognize him, that he's absolutely holy. Later, Lloyd-Jones makes this point. He argues that our main problem in Christianity is our self-centeredness. We come to Christianity looking to have our needs met. I'm not happy. Can God make me happy? I'm looking for something that I don't have. Can God give it to me? How can Christianity help me with my problems and my needs? But to approach the Christian faith in this manner is to cater to our main problem, which is self. Self. The answer of the gospel can always, in effect, be put in this way. Forget yourself. Contemplate God. Like I said last week, I went to a prayer meeting with a prayer ministry. I spent quite a bit of time there, and I was in the presence of God, and it changed me. That's the answer. The way to be delivered, this is Lloyd-Jones, from self-centeredness, is to stand in the presence of God and contemplate him and who he is. Then he goes on to make three claims. Claim number one, if we claim to have fellowship with him, and yet walk in darkness, we lie and do not live under the truth. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus, his son, purifies us from all sin. Within this first chapter, this is the fourth mention of the word fellowship. So John sees this as important, very important. If we claim to have fellowship with God, a right relationship, a claim to being a Christian, a claim to being born again, and we walk in darkness and we walk in sin, we live a lie. Our life does not tell the truth, but declares a lie. An inconsistency is what is occurring, and that's what people will see. John, as we've discussed, has been dealing with the false teachers. And if the claim is fellowship with Almighty God, then we better walk the walk rather than talk the talk. John is pressing for genuine faith, a real relationship with God. The use of the word fellowship means something is wrong in that relationship. It means that it does not mean that your salvation is lost. What it means is that you could still be saved, but you are not in the right place with God. That's where I was. There's lots of things going on inside of me that weren't right. God had to take me to a point, and I gave them to him. And then I got in the right place. If we walk in the light as he's in the light, we have fellowship one with another. If it's right with God, it'll be right everywhere else. We'd be on the same page. John says that the only way we can have fellowship, the fellowship that he's talking about, is walking in the light. Submit to the searching light of God. Ask God. Ask him, is there something in me, Lord, that I need to confess? Something will come to mind. Fellowship is not friendship. It's more than friendship. Fellowship is not companionship. These are included in fellowship. Fellowship is the deep union and unity that comes from people who all want the same thing. And this is what the early church had, which is why it was so powerful. They were all of the same heart and of the same mind. They wanted what God wanted, regardless of the cost. And then he says these things. To see holiness as something to be gained and something to be pursued, they saw it as a positive. How could they see holiness as such a thing? Because he says these great words, the blood of Jesus, his son, purifies us from all sin. Every wrong you've ever committed can be forgiven by a holy God. That's why it's called good news. That's why we're called to live in freedom. Second claim, if we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he's faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from unrighteousness. The second claim here, I think I've never ever heard a Christian. I've been saved nearly 30 years now. No Christian's ever come up to me and said, I am without sin. Never heard it. It's not the kind of thing Christians do. But I have heard Christians say they do not need to repent, which is basically saying the same thing. One of the greatest gifts of fellowship with God is he accepts us. We're sinners, we're born in sin, we commit sin without realizing we're prone to it, yet we have the offer of continual forgiveness. That's the wonder of the gospel. God's amazing grace. If we confess to God what he already knows about us, you know, some people act like, you know, I've got this great thing and I've got to give it to God, and like God's going to be shocked. You know, like God's going, I didn't know that about you. He knows everything, absolutely everything about us. If we get this right, this confession, you walk in freedom. Your fellowship is right with him. It's right with other people. There's joy. There's life. This is what he's driving at. Let's be real about where we are. Take the offer of forgiveness and enjoy a fellowship with God based on the fact that he's holy and he forgives you. He's holy and he forgives you. That's great. It's great news. Third and final claim. If we claim we have not sinned, we make him out to be a liar and his word is not in us. Abraham Lincoln was known to have said, if a man is going to be a liar, then he better have a good memory. Warren Wiersbe, who wrote a commentary on this particular verse, says when a person uses up their energy in pretending, he has nothing left for living and life. Living and life becomes shallow and tasteless. A person who pretends not only robs himself of reality, but he also keeps himself from growing. His true self is smothered under a false self. The wonder of the Bible is that it gives us examples of people who try to ignore the sin. The classic one is King David. You know the story of King David. King David is powerful. He's a king. He's got loads of wives. And yet, he still felt the need to commit adultery with Bathsheba. When they've had their affair, he then thinks it's a good idea to try and kill her husband. This is God's man, God's appointed man. And the last stupid thing he did was to think that God would overlook it. God uses a prophet to uncover his sin. But David records the following words in regards to how this sin affected him. He says this, it cost him his health. He says it in Psalms 32, verses 2 to 4. It cost him his joy, Psalm 51. It cost him his family. You look how his family reacted later on, and it was just turmoil. And it cost him his kingdom temporarily. He was booted out of Israel by one of his sons. In Proverbs 28, verse 13, God says, he that covers his sins shall not prosper. We are to be open before God, who knows everything about us, and enjoy and delight in the fact you'll find forgiveness. That's the gift of God. So let's keep it real this morning. If there is sin that needs confessing, then we can do so now. You don't have to do it publicly. You can do it privately in your seat. You can bow your heads. I'm going to give you that opportunity and offer it up to God. Let us make an honest claim in regards to our faith. The message is unchanged. The means is still the same. We tell people, and all is possible because there was one who had no sin, the man Jesus Christ. He's the one who came. He's the one that was perfect. Because of his perfection, we get a blessing. The man Jesus, the Messiah, let us hunger for fellowship with him. Amen. I'm going to give us a moment now. We're going to reflect. Maybe you want to bow your heads. Maybe you want to close your eyes. But we're going to have that time now. Just a few minutes of reflection. Father, as we come before you now. Lord, you're in this place. Your spirit is moving amongst us, Father. If there is things in our life, Lord, that we need to confess and bring to you, then reveal those things. Lord, we submit to your searching light. In you, there is no darkness. We acknowledge that, Father. And maybe as we've got our heads bowed, there's one or two that you're not really understanding what I'm talking about. You need to come into that living relationship. That can happen. It can happen by a simple prayer. As a 21-year-old student living in a squat, I prayed a simple prayer. Dear Lord Jesus, come into my life and change me. I desire to follow you. Forgive me of my sins. And guess what God did? He gave me his Holy Spirit. I felt different. Maybe that's you this morning. Maybe you need to confess that you haven't been living for him. You don't really understand what it is to live for him. Maybe you need to make and pray that same prayer. Father, we thank you, Lord, that you are good, that you are gracious, and that you are forgiving. Lord, we do pray that we store truth in our hearts, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Can we stand to sing our final hymn, please, which is These Are the Days of Elijah. Totally wrong. Very good.
sorry.
Riding on the clouds, shining like the sun, and the trumpet God, so lift your voice. It's a year of Jubilee, and out of Zion till salvation comes. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun, and the trumpet God, so lift your voice. It's a year of
Hallelujah.
Father, just bow our heads. Father, we just want to thank you, Father, that we can have a sense of humor. And we can come together to worship you here, Lord. And I just want to give all our praise to God as we go out again into this community, out of these doors this morning, or people leave the homes, or we bring love to people's homes, Father. Let us just share the love and the glory that you and only you should be given, Father. Amen.
Where did they work from? I did tell you about the word. Yeah, but then you